Mary Whitehouse's Last Laugh. All the best bits from the last series of the Mary Whitehouse Experience.
There is one phrase that is more hideous than any other.
Picture this. Recording studio somewhere far, far away.
Ooh-wee, you bugger.
It's time for
the Mary Whitehouse Experience.
First up this week, the medical experience. Now, this is the time of year when you start to hear this sort of thing non-stop.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, not too brilliant. I feel a bit fluey.
Yeah, well, there's a bit of a bug going around. Yeah. Have you got a sort of like a nagging headache and you feel tired all the time?
Yeah, I had that.
It's just some sort of a bug.
Whatever you've got, it's always just some sort of a bug. And they've always had it as well. The best thing to do with people like this is worry them. Hi, how are you?
Oh, not too brilliant. I feel a bit fluey.
Yeah, there's a bit of a bug going around. Have you got a sort of nagging headache and you feel tired all the time?
Yeah, that's right.
I think you've got a brain tumour.
Oh, right, yeah. I think there's one going round.
All through history, human beings have always suffered from illnesses, but the reaction is always the same. Ah, what ho, how goeth, sirrah?
In faith, not too good. I think I've got black death.
Yeah, there's a bit of it going round, yeah. I've had that. Yeah, have you got those kind of like huge pustules that weep?
Oh, yeah, I thought so.
That's definitely what I had. Yeah.
Did you get that sort of nausea and vomiting?
Yeah, it's black death. Yeah. Have you had the coma yet?
Oh, yeah.
I had that. And then the convulsions and the agonising death.
No, I haven't had that.
No, neither have I. It must be flu then. In medieval times, the average life expectancy was much lower than it is today, and many diseases, which are now easily curable, were then fatal.
And finally tonight, Sir Richard of Leicester, the famous soldier and elder statesman, has died aged 32, after a long struggle against a slight headache. Meanwhile, King Louis VII of France has died aged 13. He was suffering from delusions and tried to remove his own appendix, thinking he was Doogie Howser, M.D. Despite the grueling hours and long training, many people still want to enter the medical profession, attracted by its media image as portrayed in such masterpieces as Carry On Doctor. If only the NHS was really like that.
Order! Order!
Mr. Speaker, we shall be providing an additional £50 million in NHS funding this year, and this includes £10 million for large hypodermic syringes for Jim Dale to carry facing forwards when Hattie Jakes is bending over. Furthermore, we shall ensure that every hospital fruit bowl contains at least one lovely pear, in which case Barbara Windsor should visit. And I should say, Mr. Speaker, that under Labour, the resources allocated to training doctors to be able to say, oh, matron, was reduced by 50%.
One thing that does do the image of the medical profession no end of good is the behaviour of medical students. Now, the first thing that happens when you arrive at medical college is that each student is given a dead body to use for dissection. Now, anybody who's ever met anyone to do with the medical profession will know that these bodies are inevitably acquired under false pretenses.
Now, Mr. Harmsworth, this is the consent form for your grandfather's body to be used for medical research.
I see.
You understand before you sign what the terms of this form state?
Yes.
That your grandfather's body will be used in the training of anatomy and for purposes of medico-pharmacological research.
Yes.
And also that at the end of term, bits of him will be left on the bus seats for an hour, and that he may be wheeled around hospital corridors with a funny hat on as part of our post-exam celebrations.
That's what he would have wanted.
Ooh-wee, you bugger.
The Mary Whitehouse Experience.
And now, the having Workmen In experience. The first anxiety with having Workmen In is not knowing what they're talking about.
Well, it's your crappy valve, innit? And that's clearly led to an airlock in a pump and boiler. That's bunged up your overflow part and the whole system's gone into underdrive.
I see. And that's why you can't fix the blind.
The second problem is that they just can't mend what they've come to mend.
Oh, well, I could do it, but it would mean I'd have to rewire the whole place, and I'd have to knock down that wall, take up the carpet, take the roof off, demolish that block of flats over there, reverse all the human rights legislation passed in the last 45 years, trace the surviving members of the New Seekers, and become a Buddhist.
Well, I only ask you to pull your trousers up over your arse.
Yeah, a lot of plumbers in particular seem to think that the only qualification they need to have is being working class, being able to make you feel shifty in your own house. I just feel very violent when the plumber says, as they always do...
I can't work out what the trouble is.
Oh, that's all right. I really only wanted someone to come round and stink my house out for 50 quid. You must come round again, perhaps with some really cheap aftershave which you won at the fair, having spent 3 hours on the coconut shy trying to convince your kids that you're not sad.
Pornography suggests that plumbers are always getting their end away in private houses. This can only be based on an unrealistic conception of plumbers. Really, the average plumber's story in Razzle should read like this.
Imagine my surprise when the plumber arrived. He was the ugliest man I've ever seen. In the sink with his big bag of tools, he said, I haven't got the right sort of washer, and left.
The third problem is that they have to tell you that everything else in your house is also broken or rubbish.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. Who put that fuse box there? That'll never do. Oh, look, that joist's all wrong. What else? Oh, yeah, your stereo's crap. Yeah, and your wife's a bit of a dodge. Yeah. You know that photo of your mother on the mantelpiece? She looks like a right whore. Yeah. And it really stinks in here. Oh, no, that's me. Basically, your whole life is rubbish. That'd be 200 quid.
And the fourth problem revolves around the question of tea. Should you offer the workman a cup of tea? Remember that if you do so, you will have to endure the ritual that all workmen have to go through on hearing the word tea.
Tea? Tea?
Is it my birthday?
Best drink of the day.
Long as it's hot and wet.
Get that kettle on.
The day I turned out a cup of tea, Norris McWhirter will want to know.
Right then, Fred, let's have a cup of tea.
Actually, I'd rather have a coffee.
Yeah. Perhaps an Aqua Libra. The other problem is what to say to the workman. The minute he strays off the subject of either the work in hand or tea, you get filled with a liberal terror that he's going to start talking about women or the blacks. And you have to agree with him, because partly because to bring him out of these attitudes would take like years of training and debriefing and re-education, all of which time he'd charge you for, and partly because you're frightened that otherwise he might beat you up. Sometimes you might even attempt to preempt him.
I notice you've got some West Indians living next door.
Yes. Jungle bunnies, eh? Darkies, singing and dancing all night. They all look the same to me. Mm.
My wife's a West Indian.
Could you please welcome Mark Hurst?
The divorce law's been in the news, that no more quickie divorces. And vicars and priests who do these ceremonies, they can always tell which couples are going to make it, because it's their job. So they do try and give hints to the no-hopers, like, do you, Elizabeth Chalk, take Mr. Robert Cheese as your lawful wedman? And then when you get to the reception, it's all embarrassing and sickly, like the happy couple opening all their presents. So, well, you can never have too many towels, can you? Like, want to wipe that vomit up. There's a good start, haven't you? If you don't get married, you just live together. Now, that has its own set of problems, because when you're not married, you're not wholly committed. So when you have a row, you remember everything that you own in the flat. That just comes straight back to you. What do you mean, sleep on the settee? It's my bed. It's your settee as well, if you remember. I'll just go and sleep on the video recorder, shall I? Curl up in the wok. I think I bought that, didn't I? I've been in some bad relationships. I was actually in one that was directed by Alfred Hitchcock before he died. It was a psychological thriller in black and white, you know? And he even appeared as well, the obligatory cameo. He came through one day, right? We're having a row in the kitchen. It was you that left the landing light. And who's that fat guy with a cigar? Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Hello. Split. You know the sort of scene. What do you mean, where's your dinner? It's in the oven, burnt to a frazzle. Just look at the time. I'll have it anyway. What is it? Salad. Just pure venom coming out there. And of course, the sex gets less because it's hard for two people to excite each other sexually for many years. It's like a two-piece jigsaw. You just get fed up of putting it together. That's all. You know what it looks like? Just leave it in the box. That's it. And a man can't fake an orgasm. That's a problem. How could you do that? You'd have to get some theatrical sperm capsules and so on. Explode an impact for a convincing performance, darling. There you go. So eventually, the only thing you do in bed together regularly is read. And that can be lovely. Sometimes you finish at exactly the same times. Ah! Oh. Simultaneous chaptergasm we just shared there.
And now the music experience. If music be the food of love, then stock Aitken Waterman and McDonald's, and that bloke who sang Blue Velvet is a sort of old bit of cake that's been lying in the corner of the tin for 25 years.
The fact that Blue Velvet got to number one indicates one of the most irritating things about the charts at the moment. People won't buy a record unless they've heard it in an advert. One interesting aspect of this is that using a song in an advert means that people buy it who wouldn't have been seen dead buying it previously. The Steve Miller Band had quite deservedly not had a top 10 hit for 20 years until that bloke got his motorbike, passed reception and backed it carefully into the lift.
However, since it's now obvious that you can't get to number one without a song from an advert, we can expect other bands to take note.
OK, let's run down the top five on this week's brand new chart. Now, number five, it's the Happy Mondays with their version of their tasty, tasty, very, very tasty. Number four, the Sundays with their beautiful reworking of You Do the Shake and Vac and Put the Freshness Back. At three, no change, it's still Sinead O'Connor and Only the Crumbliest, Flakiest Chocolate. Open brackets, tastes like chocolate never tasted before, close brackets. At two, Adamski and We Are Lucky Cows, We Chew the Cud and Brand. But for the sixth week running, Britain's number one is still Now Hands That Do Dishes Are As Soft As Your Face with Mild Green Fairy Liquid from, of course, Public Enemy.
We start with that perennial, agonising problem making up a party tape. Real cheapskates make up a party tape by recording the songs off the radio, but of course these are very easy to spot.
And a classic hit.
Now, people fall into two categories, people who know about music and people who don't. People who know about music are, of course, the dullest people in the world. They're known as musos, and they're easily identified. Ordinary people say,
I like the twangy guitar.
Musos say,
yeah, classic Telecaster sound, right? Bridge picker, wired Dimarzio humbuckers, probably chorus through a rock box with each stereo channel panned to a different track. Yeah.
Ordinary people say,
this bloke can't sing a bleeding note.
Musos say,
yeah, interesting atonal vocal track.
Musos are the people who, when you go to a gig, they're the ones who stand right at the front so they can look at the amplifiers. At the end of the show, when everyone else is saying,
it's good, wasn't it? I really like their songs.
The musos are saying,
yeah, did you notice he was using a Fender Strat with no tremolo arm through a PV150 with rotosound round wound 009 gauges? And did you notice he played a minor 9th, third, 13th? Or on the album, he plays a minor 7th, third, 9th. I mean, because he's all technique. He's got no feel. I mean, anyone can trigger a Fairlight off a hi-hat. I mean, I'm just as good as him. I'm just as good as him. Except that I'm a sad, talentless, bitter sixth former. I mean, I'm just as good as him. Can we have the Marillion tape on in the car?
Now, lots of people try at some stage of their life to learn a musical instrument. This is usually a massively depressing experience as your expectations are far too high. When parents start their children learning the recorder, they're anticipating hearing this.
Whereas, in fact, they get this. Yeah, all right, all right. Now, even worse than this is the piano. If you walk into a room that has a piano in it, someone will go straight over to it and start going... And then, to make it worse, someone else starts going... And thanks to the Pet Shop Boys for that demonstration.
Now the fireworks experience. Now, firstly, obviously, if you are going to have a bonfire night, always obey the fireworks code.
1. Light the blue touch paper and retire to a safe distance. 2. Watch the firework go... 3. Think, shall I obey the fireworks code? 4. Think, nah, that rocket cost me £2. 5. Go back to rocket, pour some petrol over it, sit on it, relight it and say,
oh, who's going to host? Jim will fix it now.
The real fireworks code is, after all, ridiculous. If you're not allowed to go back to a firework that doesn't go off, then you have to have an unexploded rocket in your back garden for the rest of your life. And you never know when it's going to go off.
Another odd regulation of the fireworks code is, always hold fireworks at arm's length. Well, call me overzealous, but I think that's a pretty stupid thing to do with a Catherine wheel.
Some people feel that the historic significance of November the 5th has been lost in the modern commercialisation of Bonfire Night. But in actual fact, there are some links that remain between the firework galas of today and the original Catholic conspiracy of 1605.
So, Fox, King James and his parliament sit above these vaults. Hast brought all we need?
Yes.
Then set a match to it.
Oh, these sparklers are ace. Look, I can write my name with it. Oh, no, it doesn't quite work.
Oh, God, this jacket potato just isn't cooked.
Now, Catesby, hast made sure that all your pets are indoors.
I still say we should have gone to the one at the wreck.
The plot was foiled by the government because Guy Fawkes was spotted at the gates of Parliament by a guard, whose suspicions were apparently first aroused on seeing a man who was 2 feet high, made of an old pillow with a balloon for a head.
Fawkes was also perhaps the only man in the 17th century to wear an Arsenal scarf, an old pair of his dad's corduroy trousers, and travel on a wooden go-kart. He made his living from sitting outside Presto's with a badly balanced McDonald's cup propped against his leg, and he was quite different from every other member of the Catholic Anti-Parliament Alliance, who were all hard 7-year-olds.
Still, the fact remains that Guy Fawkes Night celebrates and commemorates a terrorist act, an attempt to blow up the government. So sometime in the future, are we going to be celebrating the Brighton bombing? It'll become customary every 17th of October to smash up a hotel, which may at least explain the behaviour of the young Conservatives.
Indoor fireworks, though, are completely brilliant, right, and should, we think, be used instead of the normal ones at big firework events like the Queen's birthday.
And the crowd gathered here at Waterloo Bridge are absolutely awestruck at this wonderful display. Look at that. A little black pill has kind of frothed up to look like a joke turd. And now I can see the team of 75 marshals are about to set off the grey one that curls round a bit and then smells nasty. Oh no, that one hasn't quite worked. Or perhaps it has. It's very, very difficult to tell. And now the pièce de résistance, the piece of charcoal which, when you put a match to it, catches fire. All in all, a marvellous display, well worth the £250,000 played by the City of London to the event organiser, Derek Hatton.
Looking at some of the week's news, and I picked up this Police Federation magazine. This is the actual official Police Federation magazine, and with great flair, it's called Police. There. And here's an article that I found. My name is Paul. I am 30. I am in the police. It is good. What I like is when we get people for things. Once I got someone for something, but he ran off. I found him later on and he fell down some stairs. It was good. There are lots of bad people, so I think we should have guns. What I don't like is my hat, which looks funny, and sometimes people laugh, but if I had a gun, they might not. There are some black people in the police, and sometimes we call them names and they look sad. Once the sergeant asked me which ones had been calling them names, but I said, I don't know, but I did, by Paul, age 30. So I was thinking...
the giggles?
You bugger.
Now it's the Punchline Experience. Studio audience were asked to come up to it with a punchline to this joke. This week, the two ends of the Channel Tunnel met in the middle. What were the first words exchanged between the French digger and the British digger, or vice versa? I got the first one here. Any other nationality, and I would have shaken your hand, you slimy, froggy bastard. And that's from a Mr. Nicholas Ridley. Trick or treat. That's from George the Cosmic Pink Frog. What a sad man. Oh, what a sad woman.
I like this one. Is that a hard EQ or are you just pleased to see me? Does anyone actually know what a hard EQ is here? Is it like an emu except harder? I mean,
Rod Howell.
We'd like to buy some chickens for Tesco. Based on the Tesco advert, Rob, with Dudley Moore in it.
All right.
So much for you know all about popular culture. Oh, do shut up. In the front row. God, and we'll show them what you look like. Boo. Right, I've kept this one in because I think it was in a Punch cartoon in 1834. Typical British, always digging in the opposite direction to the rest of Europe. And that's from Chris Lowe. Well,
he's the quiet one of the pet shop boys as well. A worthy point, Chris, made in an entirely unfunny way. Thank you. Oh dear, oh dear. Le French. Bonjour. The Brit. Here, Bert, what's he talking about? And, that's from Steve Randall, who's the man over there wearing the ARP Warden's hat.
Let's have a cheer, first of all, for Steve Randall, who did the Bonjour, Ear Bert, what's he talking about, Steve Randall? Versus, is that a hard EQ, or are you just pleased to see me, by Mark Brandt. Mark Brandt wins. Big round for Mark Brandt, wherever he is.
I want to be rich.
I want to be happy.
I wanted to be Prime Minister.
I want a new coat.
I want to meet Mike Yarwood.
I want to see a decent game of cricket where England are less crap.
I'm not bitter, but I really did want to be Prime Minister.
I want a nice gabardine one with a belt. Just like Michael Bronson's.
I want to be a size 12.
I want to be in Brookside.
I want to be alive.
I mean, the environment is all very well, but number 10 would really have been the business.
Well, maybe I'd get one of those nice Parkers with a hood.
I want to be this of a computer and a door transport.
I want to be sick every time I see this commercial. And now, the phone experience. This week, British Telecom announced plans to charge 50p for the use of directory inquiries. Presumably, this is to cover the cost of employing somebody to twist the announcer's scrotum as he says the numbers.
The number you require is 0714348762. Exterminate.
What is the point when you can use the phone book, which you can also use to find people with funny names and ring them up with your mate giggling?
Hello, 4325674, Alan Smelly speaking.
Boar! Are you smelly? Hey, are you smelly? Am I talking to a smelly?
Oh dear.
Hello, are you smelly?
Yes.
We'll have a bath then.
That was the funniest thing ever. Now, who wants a curly whirly?
People with names that might involve this kind of victimisation often try and avoid it by taking liberties with pronunciation.
Hello, 432-5672, Mr. Wah and Kerr speaking.
Oh, it doesn't work quite so well now. Is that a Wah and Kerr?
A genuine one of these is that there are people in the phone directory called Shuffle Bottom. This is true. But no matter how often or how late you ring them up, they will always insist on their name actually being Shufle Botham. It's true. I suppose it's fair enough if you are named after a method of canine personal hygiene.
Now, the other main experience a kid has with phones is making a rudimentary telephone out of two labelless baked bean tins attached by a piece of string through a hole in the Botham. Now, the point about these things, right, is they never work. You think at first they do work until you realise you're just hearing your friend in the other ear. Like, not that you'd hang around with him during term time anyway.
In fact, these were completely pointless, as by the time you got the string long enough not to hear your friend in the other ear, it was too long to carry the sound vibrations. And then all you might be able to make out was the sound of him getting run over in the road outside.
But the most valuable phone accessory is the answer phone, although not if you insist on putting a wacky outgoing message on it. In fact, normally, the more wacky the outgoing message, the sadder the life of the person who made it.
Hey, you're through to Ken Collins' crazy loony bin. I'm out with Maria Whittaker at the moment. Not really. So, leave me a message off the tone, but I shouldn't think I'll phone you back. I'm too busy partying. Start spreading the news. I'll leave it today.
Hello, Mr. Collins. This is the gas board. You're sacked.
Hello, this is Gary Davis, and you are the supreme champion of the day-to-day challenge.
Ken, this is your mother. Ta-ra.
You can now buy these answer messages with impressions of famous people already on them. Unfortunately, the friends of the type of people who are likely to buy these are likely to be confused by them.
Oh, sorry, Prince Charles, I didn't know you'd moved in with Barry.
Most of the phone network, however, is now occupied by sex lines. These have proliferated so much that in an average newspaper, there is now more space devoted to adverts for sex lines than to the Gulf crisis. The effects of their popularity could be far-reaching on all types of news media.
He wears her panties on 0898-444-444. I'll bend over so you can see on 0898-444-455. And on 0898-444-555, he's got a woman's name, Sandy.
The point about 0898 numbers is that they have no sex in them at all. You're more likely to get a hard-on phoning the speaking clock, right?
Now, Mr. Ernie Spencer of Wiltshire sent us in a letter asking to know the history of the telephone. Well, Mr. Spencer, here goes. The telephone was invented in February the 14th, 1876, by Alexander Graham Bell. And the tape still exists in the Science Museum archives of that first ever telephone conversation, recorded on March the 10th, 1876.
This is Alexander Graham Bell speaking.
Are you A. Bell? Hello, is that A. Bell I can hear?
Yes, yes, it is.
Well, you better go and see who's at the door then.
That was the funniest thing ever. Now, who wants a bald humbug?
You've been listening to the Merry Whitehouse Experience.
Good finger!
It was written and performed by David Baddiel, Rob Newman, Steve Punt, Hugh Dennis and Mark Hurst. The producer was Armando Iannucci.
Thank you, Miss Bassey. But don't go in.
Yes, thank you.
His heart is cold.
Yes, thank you very much, Miss Bassey. Thank
you. It loves only gold.
Shut up.